Hello everyone, I am Zach Peterson. Welcome back to my channel. Very happy you're here today because we are going to be talking about differential pairs and I'm going to be answering your questions from my recent Altium Academy video all about whether or not differential pairs need ground to function. Now this video was a lot of fun to make and of course there were a ton of comments on this video and so I pulled out five of the best viewer questions and I'm going to answer those questions on this video today. Let's hop in and get started. Let's take a look at our first question. This first question comes from Mark Datton 1348. Super cool stuff. I haven't seen anyone else cover this type of detail in PCB design, and it's really useful for someone less experienced to get an intuition for behavior on a PCB. Well, thank you very much, Mark. It sounds like this applies heavily to not just things like USB, but also PCIe. I have always wondered how boards are routed in order to achieve the bus clock speeds for PCIe devices, and this starts making sense. Some of the traces seem like they need to be very close together to make sure they are self-referential as possible in order to make each serial pair as stable as possible, or maybe I am misunderstanding. This is a really great question, and essentially what Mark is asking is whether or not the two traces in a differential pair have to be very close to each other in order for the interface, for the differential interface, to function. So what do we mean by the interface functioning? Well, we mean that the interface is able to register data coming into it on each of the polarity signals in the differential pair and then interpret a logic state from those two polarity signals. Now, as a designer, your task is to ensure that you size and space the differential pairs such that this channel provides enough bandwidth so that the interface can interpret any signals coming into it as the correct logic states. So how do you do that? Do you have to put the traces in the pair very close together, or can you space them far apart? Well, really, you have a choice. You can put them very close together, but oftentimes it's much better to put them very far apart. Now, if you put them very close together and you don't have any impedance deviations along the length of the traces, meaning you don't make a lot of turns or you don't have any length tuning sections, then the traces are going to function just fine. And the benefit of doing that is you're going to get maximum noise suppression from that differential pair. It's also going to have the highest immunity to differential crosstalk or to single-ended crosstalk. Now, of course, the trade-off here is that as you bring the traces closer and closer together, you're forced to make them smaller to overcome the parasitic capacitance that exists between the traces in the pair. Now, if you make the traces smaller, you start to increase your copper losses. So you increase the skin effect and the DC losses. The other thing is if you make them too close together, you force your traces to be so small that you might not even be able to fabricate them. And that's especially a problem if you're trying to fabricate strip lines. However, if you're going to make some turns and twists in the routing for your differential pairs, it's better to space the pairs farther apart. That way, your length tuning sections that you implement in your differential pair will create much less mode conversion. So that's something that's very important because mode conversion basically converts between common mode signal and differential signal. And we would like our differential signal that we put onto a differential pair to remain a differential signal. That way the differential receiver doesn't cancel it should any of that signal get converted into common mode. And then finally, how do you ensure that the differential channel has enough bandwidth to provide power to the receiver? Well, half of the battle is choosing the right materials. And of course, if you start to have high losses on long routes, you then need to choose a material that has a lower loss tangent. Now, one way to overcome the higher skin effect losses due to the smaller conductors is of course to also use a smaller dielectric constant as it forces you to use larger traces. So both of those things go together and they help ensure that the channel has enough bandwidth so that your interface can operate correctly. This next question comes from Rahul and he writes, "Hi Zach, thanks for the valuable insights. I have a question. I have a PCB with 1.2 millimeter thickness and 6 layers. I am running USB signals in the bottom layer. I have a split power plane adjacent to the bottom layer. Will it impact the USB signals? Unfortunately, I am not able to provide a ground plane in the fifth layer as I need a power plane." So my response to this is, we actually created a simulation video that looks at this particular situation, but it looks at it in the context of strip lines, not with microstrips. So with strip lines, it's actually quite common to route strip lines over a split in a power layer when one of the plane layers that's used to reference your strip lines is used just for power. So it's actually quite common to do that. And when we looked at this from the context of signal integrity, what we found is that you don't really have sufficient bandwidth limiting until those splits get pretty large. Then you're able to see the effects of the splits in the S parameters, and you start to see it in the 10 gigahertz range or higher. Now, if you're doing this on the bottom layer and you have, let's say, your reference layer on layer 5 and you put a split in that reference layer, we haven't examined that in a video or in a simulation, but I would suspect that you're going to have bandwidth limiting at much lower frequency than is the case with strip lines. So I would not be surprised if the additional reflection that you see due to bandwidth limiting and due to the impedance mismatch from routing over that split to appear at, let's say, 5 gigahertz or something even lower. So you do have a risk of limiting the channel bandwidth in your USB channel in that situation where you're routing on the bottom layer. Now, maybe that interface works just fine even though you have some reflection. I don't know what data rate you're working at, and I don't know how much bandwidth this channel needs in order for your USB lines to function. Could be working at the full speed spec or just the high speed spec, could be USB 3.0. Not enough information from the question. But I will say this, the interface could function correctly, but that reflection from that split could also create an EMI problem, which you notice in EMI testing. And so that could cause the board to potentially fail. So I think the moral of the story here is just because you have a board that functions and is able to read data correctly, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's fully compliant with radio emissions regulations. To overcome this problem, consider doing coplanar ground on the layer with your USB signal if you have the room for it. Of course, coplanar ground requires doing some copper pour on the bottom layer around those USB signals. And in a dense layout, you generally don't have room for that. But hey, maybe in your situation, you do have room for it. So give that a try. All right, let's take a look at our next question. This question comes from Danden. And Dan asks, what would happen if we have a thick trace for ground between a differential pair on the same plane on a two-sided board? Well, the first thing I'm going to say is that's a pretty puny way to provide enough ground for a differential pair. So you should probably just use a ground plane, even if it is a two-layer board. Now, what you're trying to do in this situation, or as you've described it, by placing a trace between the traces in your differential pair, is almost to form, like, for example, a guard trace. Essentially, the guard trace becomes a reference for each of the traces in that differential pair. But it's not really guarding from anything. It's not being placed between, let's say, two differential channels or between two single-ended traces. So you could put a guard trace or put this ground trace in between the traces in your differential pair if you want, but I don't know how much of an effect it's going to have on the impedance. Normally, if you're going to do coplanar ground, you would just do it around the traces in the differential pair, rather than trying to muck with this situation where you just have a ground trace in between two regular traces. Like I said, I really don't think having a simple ground trace between two traces in the differential pair is going to provide much benefit, and it's not really going to help you size the traces down to the level that you need on a two-layer board. I would really just suggest using coplanar ground on that two-layer board for your differential pair. This next question comes from KP6137. KP writes, when do we choose single coplanar and differential coplanar in 9 minutes and 28 seconds? So that's one of the timestamps on the original video. Can you make another video to discuss this? Well, sure, I can make another video to discuss it, but I guess we're doing that right now, aren't we? So this relates to the previous question, and really the most common reason you would choose in this context differential coplanar ground is when you have something like USB on a two-layer board. Now, you shouldn't use most differential interfaces on a two-layer board because they're operating at such high data rates and there's a risk of such high noise that you really need to have that ground plane closer to those differential traces. The other reason you need to do that is because you just need to have those differential traces thin, and they tend to be coming off of components with a lot of other traces, and so you just don't have the room to put coplanar ground, and you have to have the ground from a ground plane. Now, if you just have a single differential pair, for example, USB lines, and you need to provide ground for them so that you can size those traces to be a reasonable value, like let's say 10 mils, then you would want to have coplanar ground, and that forms your coplanar differential pair. Essentially, we do the same thing, for example, with impedance-controlled RF lines on two-layer boards. Not all RF boards are on four layers. You can build an RF board on two layers. Now, there are reasons to do it on four layers, but you can use coplanar ground on a two-layer board in order to bring the size of that RF trace down to a reasonable level so that you can route it into and out of components. The same would apply with other impedance-controlled buses that use single-ended lines. Of course, the most common would be like SDRAM. Now, those lines also need to have 50 ohm impedance, and if you only have a two-layer board, the only way you're gonna get to very narrow trace widths with 50 ohm impedance is if you use the coplanar ground. Unfortunately, those very large parallel buses take up so much space that they really don't leave a lot of room for coplanar ground. And so really the best solution in that case is just to bite the bullet and go with a four-layer board. And our last question comes from John Rowe 3779. He writes, isn't it true in most layouts that the field at each trace is mostly contained in the space between the trace and the reference plane, not the other trace? I think the magic of diff pairs and cables and UHDI was shown, but for most board designs, it's a different animal, right? Well, the reality is that some of the field lines converge to the other trace, but some of the field lines also converge to the reference plane. It's not an either-or situation. The same applies to the return current. Yes, each trace does reference the other trace and they provide the return current for each other, but they also capacitively couple some return current into the return plane. As long as you have the two polarity signals referenced to each other in space, meaning that they are synchronized in space and time, then the return current for each of those traces is going to dominate in the other trace, and you will have equal and opposite return current in the ground plane co-located in space. Now the net result is that whether you're routing strip lines or microstrips, you do have the field contained in the space around the traces, and those field lines do compress into the dielectric region between the traces and the reference plane. It's not that you don't have any field between the two traces, you do. It's just that the distribution is slightly different than if you just had a single-ended trace on its own. So to see some examples of field lines around differential traces, I suggest you head over to Google Images and just Google field lines around differential traces, and you'll see some pretty good field line diagrams that show what I'm talking about. So I said that we only had five questions, but there is one last comment that I want to look at here from Vishrut Dave. Vishrut writes, hi Zach, very insightful video on theoretical versus practical case on this topic, although it still begs the question as to how much degradation we see in signal integrity of a differential pair when the tight coupling of that pair is broken due to chokes or coupling caps or a via in its path. This is a great question. And of course, it justifies the use of larger spacing between the traces in the differential pair. Now, I mentioned one reason earlier, which was mode conversion. When you have larger spacing between the traces in your differential pair, you get lower mode conversion whenever you start doing curves or whenever you start doing length tuning. Now, if you have the traces closer together, of course, it makes it more difficult and it creates a higher risk of mode conversion when you start to do things like, for example, add length tuning, or as is mentioned in the question, add things like coupling capacitors or chokes. When you have your traces close together, you usually have to break those traces out just a little bit in order to reach the coupling caps or the chokes. Now, of course, if you're operating in a low bandwidth channel, let's say 1 gigahertz or less channel bandwidth requirement, then breaking out the traces like that might not matter. But if you're working with, for example, very high bandwidth requirement, let's say 10 gigahertz or 20 gigahertz, one of these really high SerDes channels or something like very high data rate Ethernet, then you are going to have a problem if you start to break out the traces like that, because now you're going to not only create a problem with impedance mismatch, but that then creates problems with reflections. So this deserves its own video, and it's something I'll look into on this channel as well as on the Altium Academy channel. So make sure to go over to Altium Academy and subscribe, and you'll be able to see that video. As always, thanks everyone for your questions on my videos from Altium Academy. And of course, if you ask some great questions here on these videos, they might just end up in one of our Q&A sessions. Make sure to hit that subscribe button on my channel. Make sure to head over to Altium Academy and hit subscribe, hit that like button, and we'll see you next time. Thanks everybody. Thank you.